There are many treatment centers across the United States, but when someone is seeking to recover from a destructive lifestyle of drugs and alcohol abuse or any other controlling problem that is tearing them apart, where can they find long-lasting help? The guests on our program today will share their stories and about a ministry that has had a 50-year proven treatment method that has transformed hearts and lives throughout the generations. Their vision is to help rebuild the lives of men, women, and children and see them become productive citizens, discovering their God-given purpose in life.
Healing rain is coming down, it's coming nearer to this old town. The rich and poor, the weak and strong, it's bringing mercy, it won't be long. Healing rain is coming down, it's coming closer to the lost and found. Tears of joy and tears of shame are washed forever in Jesus' name. It comes with fire, so let it fall and take us high. Healing rain, I'm not afraid to be washed in heaven's rain. Lift your head. Where time began. In your eyes, I see the pain. Come soak these dry hearts with healing rain. And only you, the Son of Man, could take a leper. So lift your hands that can be held by someone greater than great I am. Healing rain, it comes with fire, so let it fall and take us high. Healing rain. Be washed in heaven's
I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid. Hear the rain is falling down.
Hear the rain
is falling down. I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid. Hear the rain.
Welcome to the Everlasting Love Program. We hope that you enjoyed the music at the top of our show. And we want to remind you that you are loved with an everlasting love. You can find us on our YouTube channel, and you can also find us online at everlastinglovetv.com. And today we have the privilege of hearing from some gentlemen from Teen Challenge here in Chicago. We have Pastor Harper with us, who is the state director for Teen Challenge in Illinois. And we also have Jonathan, who is a graduate of the program, and Alex is currently in the program. So thank you so much for being here today. We want to invite you to go to our website and check us out for more details. Also wanted to give our phone number to you in the event that you wanted prayer, or maybe we could help you find a church in the area. 773-286-2172. We would love to hear from you. Well, thank you again so much for being here today and sharing your stories. I just know in advance that God is going to bless our time together today, as well as the people who have tuned in to our show. And I would just love to start out by hearing your stories of faith, your testimonies. What was life like for you prior to coming to faith, coming to Christ, and what is it like now? What transformation have you seen? So Pastor Harper, if it's okay, we'll start with you. Tell us a little bit about your story.
Well, thank you for having me, Lisa, on the show today. I'm probably the oldest graduate that you'll hear today. I graduated from the program 40 years ago.
Wow.
And never relapsed. So that's the power
that
this program brings to it. And of course now, I'm the state executive director for Teen Challenge Illinois.
Great.
So my story goes back 40 years ago. As a 19-year-old, I always say black hippie because we're in the minorities there too, you know.
Okay.
Just think Jimi Hendrix, you know, you think about
that. That's a
that.
Good visual.
Yeah, it's a good visual. So that's what my life was like. Grew up in that love, rock, acid, rock and roll deal. A little different for a black guy during that particular time, but kind of drifted into that culture and lived my life in that realm for a while. Started doing drugs when I was about 15 years of age and had about 5 years or 4 years of drug abuse, heavy drug abuse, in the area of psychedelic drugs and marijuana, some cocaine, very little heroin, but it controlled my life. At 19 years of age, of course, I had already gone to, did about 90 days in jail, and it was really a wake-up call for me, and with some probation, but it was in that free love era. So probation meant nothing, rules didn't mean anything to me. So I took off and went to California. Wanted to go to Haight-Ashbury, Lisa, you know, where the flower children were and all that stuff, and Berkeley University, and, you know, just experiencing life, hitchhiked back from California across country, 1971, you know, and just involved with a lot of different things that became overwhelming. And then I came to the end of my rope. My dad was an awesome man. I miss him so much. He had his own business, and I worked with him in his business. We had a painting business where we painted houses outside and a cleaning service, and we just had a great time together. But life really got off track. I mean, in a big way. Life started crashing down in so many different areas, even to the place where I came to the place where I wanted to take my life, and I tried. In fact, I was somewhat successful, but very unsuccessful because I'm still here. But unsuccessful because one night I just took some Tylenols and Secanols and alcohol and carbona cleaning fluid and drank that cocktail down.
Do you remember what was going through your heart and mind at that time that just led you that place of desperation, saying, you know what, I'm done?
It was a very dark place, a place of despair, a place of brokenness. Mm-hmm. You know, and as a 19-year-old kid, I didn't have the testimony of, you know, the ghetto and all that stuff. We lived in a very affluent area, a gated community. Dad was a real hard worker. But it kind of tells you that riches or money and success cannot buy your freedom when you're in bondage. Mm-hmm. So those are the kind of things that kind of cause life to kind of spin out of control for me.
So you had a good upbringing.
Oh,
you said a great relationship with your dad.
Yeah, dad was awesome. He was a great man. My mom and dad split up. My mom lived in Florida, my dad was in Connecticut. So as a 14-year-old kid, they said it was time for you to go and live with your dad. And I thought that was a great idea. He spoiled me. He loved me more than oxygen.
Wow.
You know, so it's
so a great, how does a kid go from being loved more than oxygen to that low point?
There's a lot of different factors, I think, that kind of pulled me away from the home and the family setting there as it was. The drugs, the alcohol, the peer pressure was there. I was always a leader, though. I always had leadership. I always wanted to be the person who was giving the orders or sharing what people should do. And even in my addiction, there was leadership. I would tell people I was in the pharmaceutical business, you know, also selling drugs, you know. And so that sort of tore at the very fabric of our lives to the place where I tried to take my very own life.
So then what happened after you had attempted to take your life?
Well, there was a stint also in the mental institution. It's amazing that you said that, because I always think of Sandy Hook, because we lived in Connecticut, and in Newtown, Connecticut was a place where the mental hospital was. And that night when I tried to take my life, that's where I ended up, right there in Newtown. I just thought that there was some, I think about it today, that there was some stronghold there that wanted to take my life, but I ended up there. And it was amazing, because I was doing the Thorazine shuffle, they call it, because they tried to treat me. They tried to find the answer, what was going on the inside of me. I had been to many treatment programs, with therapeutic programs, where the ideal was to tear you down from the outside to get to the inside. What I needed was someone to get on the inside and build me up, and so he could show himself strong on the outside. And that took place. It's an amazing story, because I had went to California, came back, there was probation violations, and there was a young man who had gone through Teen Challenge because dad couldn't find me to go to work. And he was there. And one day I just noticed while we were painting a house that he would disappear at lunchtime. Couldn't understand it for the life of me. And out in the backyard of a house that we were painting, he was praying. And I said, what are you doing? Who are you praying to? You know, he says, I'm praying to Jesus. I said, Jesus who? We went to church. I call us C, M, and E Christians. We went Christmas, Mother's Day, and Easter.
Oh, that's a new
and
one.
And I had a suit for those times.
Yeah.
And for court. So wore the same suit for court and for those special occasions. But this young man was outside. And I went back and said, what are you doing? Who are you talking to? And he says, I'm talking to Jesus. I said, really? I said, boy, that was the guy who died on the cross. He couldn't help himself. His own friends deserted him. He said, but he didn't desert me in my time of need. He said a key word, Lisa. He says, I just finished a program. I said, program? Wow, I need a program, because I'm getting ready to go back to jail. He says, if you come to this program, your life can be totally changed. I said, really? Went to the program. I said, this is easy. I can do this. Because I'd been to all the other programs, and they didn't work. But this one was something different about this particular program. I entered into that program in the month of August in 1972. And, you know, I said, I'm just going to do the game, just kind of go along with it. I'm a quick study learner, so all the language was very easy to learn. They said things like, praise the Lord, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, amen. So I got the language of the kingdom down pretty fast. I said, oh, this is easy. I can do this. But it got a little bit harder, because you can only play that game for so long, even in the program. And on September 5th, 1972, I had an experience, a life-changing, life-altering altering experience with Jesus.
And what happened?
Well, the program is pretty controlled. So if they tell you if you got to go to church on a Wednesday night, you got to go to church on a Wednesday night. So we all climbed in a station wagon at that time. That was the SUV of that day, probably. Mm-hmm. And we went there, and all of a sudden, there was the message that was being given. And I found myself, before the sermon was finished, while the preacher had just really started, getting up, walking to the altar. And from there, I had an experience with Christ, went back to my seat, went back to the program, and went down to the chapel after that. And there was something that touched my life that totally changed me and altered, I believe, my very destiny. I attribute all the things that I have accomplished, if I've accomplished anything in this life, to that experience, but the program, Teen Challenge.
So tell me how your life, obviously, is radically different.
Oh, it's radically changed.
Since when you were 19. So tell us a little bit about Christ enters into your life.
I go through the program, I ask Christ into my life. There was this awesome experience that I had with him alone by myself that just really took over my life. But there was so much more to learn about Christ. So after graduating the program, I went to work back in the program again. We call it giving back. Mm-hmm. Every student that you hear tonight, they'll talk about, well, you know, I'm going to graduate the program, but I'm going to come back and give some time back to people who were hurting or who are hurting just like I was. So I did that for 6 months up in Rochester, New York. I left there, and I went to Bible college.
Wow.
That was an awesome experience. Mm-hmm. But what I had learned in Teen Challenge transferred also over into my college experience. I met the most beautiful woman in Bible college who became my wife.
That's
and we've
exciting.
Been married for 38 years. We've been married. Mm-hmm. And from there, I started pastoring my very first church when I was 23 years old as the senior pastor.
Wow.
Because God had done such a work in my life. We only had 15 people. I couldn't mess it up, you know. But on the same token, when I finished that church, when I left that particular church and moved to the next one, there was over 500 people there. God saved people radically. There was a scripture that we learned in Teen Challenge in 2 Timothy 2:2. Paul says this to Timothy. He says, "In the things that you have heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also." So that's what we do in Teen Challenge. We call it the spiritual law of reproduction.
That's awesome. And I want to hear a lot more about the program.
So there's
given
more.
Us a great bridge.
Okay.
I'd love to hear from Jonathan. I think you've graduated from Teen
yes.
Challenge, correct? So tell us a little bit about your story. What was life like for you before coming to Christ, and what was that turning point for you, and what is life like for you now?
My name is Jonathan. I'm 28 years old. I recently graduated at the end of October this past year. I came into the program August of 2012. My life growing up, I grew up without a father figure in my life. My parents got divorced when I was about 8 years old. And there was a lot of abuse, there was a lot of trauma going on in that relationship. So I believe that a lot of my issues that I self-medicated came from my childhood. Mm-hmm. I know that now. I didn't realize that then, but I know that most of the issues that I dealt with were coming from that traumatic experience as a child. And there are certain things that a father has to teach a child,
yeah.
a man, in order for a man to grow up and become a successful man. And I was lacking that in my life. My mom did the best she could. She worked 2-3 jobs, put herself through school, but there's only so much that she can do as a single parent. And I started to get into trouble. I started to want to medicate these feelings that I was having, these anxieties, these worries, these fears, anger issues mm-hmm. that I really had towards my father, but I used alcohol, drugs, started at an early age, about 16 years old in high school, drinking with friends, and it escalated really from there.
Let me ask you a quick question. So you wanted to medicate some of the pain that you were experiencing at that time. Did you ever think that you would end up hooked, that you would end up addicted to alcohol, to drugs, and that it would take over your life when you started dabbling?
No. I said, I'll never be the guy with a needle sticking out of my arm. Mm. I'll never be the guy popping pills. It will not. I'll control it.
Yeah.
It'll get that far. But I know it's a lie from the enemy. Mm-hmm. He has you deceived into thinking you can handle this area of your life when you can't. From the beginning, it's totally out of control.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, it escalated. Small little compromises. Got into prescription pain medicine. And that opened the door to, you know, a full-blown heroin addiction.
Yeah.
Because it's easier to get, it's more plentiful, and it's cheaper.
Mm-hmm.
That's why there's such a huge epidemic with heroin, you know, especially here in the Chicagoland area, because it's easy to get, and it's freely available.
And when you would go to shoot up heroin or do heroin, what now, as you look back at, what lie would you tell yourself every time you were going to?
I'd say, you know, I have a job interview in a couple of weeks. I can quit. You know, after this, I can stop, or I can cut it in half.
Hmm.
I can cut the dosage in half, or I can not do as much. But if anybody knows, the amount that you get is usually gone the same night that you get it, and then you're out looking for more.
So you always have this intention that I'm going to stop tomorrow, just one more time, or I'm going to wean myself off. But that's not the case when you have an addiction. Like, you can't get yourself out on your own. So you get to this point where you're addicted, you need something to change. What happened for you next?
Well, it escalated to a point where I was losing jobs. I couldn't, once the addiction gets to a certain, you can't function as a heroin addict and keep a job or family relationships. I was living out of my car. It had gotten to the point where I wasn't welcome anywhere with any family, any friends. I was living out of my car, which was going to be repossessed shortly. I was about to lose my job. I was about to get drug tested at the job that I was working at, and I was about to lose that as well. So I knew I had this sense of impending doom coming. I knew that the wheels were going to fall off the train soon. I knew I could only maintain this for a certain amount of time.
So what did intervention look like for you?
Well, there was one morning I was coming home from the job that I was working, and I was under the influence, and I nodded off and went into the curb in my car. I woke up about 10 minutes later, and no police, no anybody around, so I pulled into a gas station, changed my tire, and I called my mom. I reached out to her because she was the only family member in my life that is still not giving up on me. I knew no matter what I did that she would still be there. She wouldn't let me drown.
Yeah.
So I reached out to her and I said, I don't have any food. I don't have any money because I spent it all on drugs. I had put 9 months together of clean time prior to this through a secular rehab program, which didn't work.
Hmm.
So this was news to her that I had relapsed. So I asked her if I could come stay at the house. I said, I have nowhere to go. I said, my car is damaged. You know, I should have been arrested for what happened because of what I had on me and what was in the car. So I see that was the grace of God intervening in that circumstance to get me into the program. You know, because it could have went a lot of different ways. I could have been arrested.
So how did you hear about Teen Challenge?
She actually suggested it to me because I came to her house and she said, you need to get on the computer right now and you need to find somewhere to go because you can't stay here.
Mm-hmm.
So she had to eliminate all my options. I had to have no other option but to go into the program. She cut off living with her, all my friends, cut off their places. My other family members cut off their places. God had to back me into a corner to get me in the position that this was the only option.
Mm-hmm. And it's in that program where you met Jesus for the first time?
Yes.
Tell us about that.
I actually came into the program as a non-believer. My mom had always been a Christian. She'd always tried to get me to come to church with her, to read the Bible with her, pray with her, but I'd always reject it. And when I came in, I was sick. I was still detoxing. I was about 2 days in, but it was different than every other detox that I've been through in the fact that I had a peace. I still had that peace despite all the pain, despite the turmoil, despite the circumstances. I had an inner peace that I'm finally in the right place. That I'm finally in a position where I surrendered. I gave up. I said, I'm not fighting. I can't fight this anymore. I'm out. I'm out of ammunition, so to speak. So there was a Christian rap group actually that came to perform one night in a chapel service, and they did their set, which I really enjoyed. And then the father of the group came up and he preached, and he had an altar. He you know, called us to the altar after the service. Said, if anybody would like to accept Jesus, you know, we'll pray this prayer with you. And I sat and I talked with him, and he led me to Christ that night. And I felt this overwhelming sense of peace that, you know, it's not going to be an easy journey, but that he was there. And once I opened the door, once I showed that little bit of willingness, that he could work with that. But my heart had to be willing to let him in.
Absolutely. So how would you describe your life now that you invited Christ in?
It's been awesome. I'm now working at the Chicago Center that I came through as a staff member, teaching classes.
Wow.
Something I never
That's
thought
awesome.
That I would ever do
yeah.
in my life. I couldn't have told you a year and a half ago that I would ever be doing what I'm doing today. Mm-hmm. And if God has a plan for you, he's going to fulfill it, and he's going to put you in that position. And I had no idea that he was going to have me do these things. It's great to pour back into the lives of these guys, just like my life was poured into by these men, you know, the staff members at Teen Challenge, and I wanted to give that back to the ministry, and I want to continue my career with the ministry also.
And that's the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Surprising in every way.
Amen.
When we think as humans we can control our destiny and where our choices will lead, God says, yeah, no, I'm bigger than that, and I have... For I know the plans I have for you, declares yes. the Lord. And Amen. we surrender and allow him to take over, and he transforms us.
It's just like, you know, 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation.
Yes.
The old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new.
Mm-hmm.
That's all things.
Mm-hmm.
I'm constantly becoming a new creation in Christ, day by day.
What if someone were to say, okay, Jonathan, that's great for you, but I don't know if God could intervene and rescue me in that way. What would you say to them?
I would say that my life is a living testimony that he can.
Yeah.
That you have to, but in order for him to work in your life, you have to acknowledge a need for him.
Mm.
You know, I had to get to a certain point in my life where I needed help. I needed to get to a point where my pride was not getting in the way anymore. Just saying, I can handle this till I can do this and I can do that. And God can work in anybody's lives, and he can deliver anybody from anything. We just have to make that first step
yeah.
and accept it.
It takes a lot of humility, as
yes.
you said. We tend to be prideful human beings
yes,
by nature,
do.
Right?
Yes, we do. Yeah.
So it's the humility and humbleness of asking him to enter in. And it's so cool about God. He's like waiting for us,
mm-hmm.
waiting for the invitation for him to come in to
Absolutely.
Our lives. Thank you so much for sharing
Thank you for
your
having
story
me.
With us. Alex.
Yes.
It's your turn.
I'm so
You've
excited.
You've been waiting so patiently.
I have been.
But I've been seeing you nod, and you had a smile on your face the whole time as your comrades shared here. It must be a blessing to see others around you and their lives changing.
Is. It definitely is. Revelation 12 talks about the word of our testimony and the blood of the Lamb being able to thwart the plans of the evil one. And it just shows us how much power there is behind testimony.
Yeah.
That's why we're all so excited to be up here. But my life started actually kind of the completely opposite of Jonathan. I grew up in a very God-fearing church, God-fearing parents, God-fearing grandparents, aunt, uncle, cousins. We filled the entire balcony at church.
Wow.
So definitely knew my Bible growing up, was on every mission trip, you know, around the world, went to conferences, you know, always was at youth group, always was involved, actually spent some time in some private Christian schools. So I knew the word, problem was it was only head knowledge.
Mm.
And I still wanted to live for my own pleasures Monday through Saturday. When Sunday came along, I wanted to feel holy for that hour and a half during the church service and then go back to my own way of living. But I always tell people I felt like I was grandfathered into heaven. I felt, you know what? I know, you know, Jesus is Lord. I feel like I can drift right into heaven. That, you know, but the problem is you drift into sin. And I felt like the guy in Matthew 7 when he says, Lord, Lord, didn't I prophesy in your name? I do great works in your name? And he said, I never knew you. And so that's, you know, was a big turning point in my life. And as I grew up, just normal issues of life, marriages, finances, things like that. I masked normal problems with alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
And instead of turning to Christ and surrendering my issues with him, I tried to mask things. I tried to hide my problems. I, you know, created lie after lie with those who were closest to me out of shame. thinking that, you know, I was abnormal if I had any sort of problem in my life. And just keep, you know, and the more I did that, the farther I got away from Christ, the farther
Let me just say something about the shame thing, because I think we all, like, all of us, people watching me, all of us here, we all experience shame.
Absolutely.
And the lie of the enemy is, as you were saying, Alex, that, oh, you're the only one. So he likes to isolate.
Right.
And so we hide our sin from one another. And God's word says, bring your sin out into the light, confess your sins to one another. And that's where real freedom and power can come from. But we do have that guilt, so we want to be in hiding.
Absolutely.
So tell us a little bit more. What happened next?
Well, because of my sin, it actually led to a divorce and a time stint in jail. And I spent about 7 months in jail. And I remember on September 11th of last year, I completely broke down and rededicated my life to Christ. And I said to him, I'm like, you are going to be my number one priority. I can't live without you at the center of my life anymore. And it was just such a blessed time for me. And my life since then has never been the same. My parents have still stuck by my side, and they've been amazing. And they have told, when I was in jail, they told me testimony after testimony of people and that have been through Teen Challenge, and have just described it as a factory of hope, that when you have no other option left other than Christ, I mean, that there's just no other option. And Teen Challenge helps you get your mind focused from the earthly realm to the heavenly realm, and to understand that Christ does have, like, just like what you were saying out of Jeremiah 29:11, that he does have a plan for our life, he does have a future for us, but it's, we have to accept his love, we have to receive his love, and we have to submit, and we have to surrender our life to him. And my life, like I said, has never been the same. And but you have to get to that rock bottom point. If you're going on that path, he's going to bring you to your rock bottom, because he wants to woo you back to him. He wants to show you that he'll put up a stop sign in your life, whether it's jail, whether it's, you know, sickness, whether it's ruined relationships. He wants to have that relationship with you. And so instead of viewing it as, you know, a God who's out to get you or to punish you, it's the complete opposite. He's wooing you back to himself. And once you realize that, your life isn't going to be the same ever again.